This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Well, today on Dreamland, we have a treat in store. Cinema symbolism. Robert Sullivan is back with us. This is his fourth visit to Dreamland. He has been on the show since 2009, and every show he's done has been loads of fun. And why is that? Because we're all fascinated by the movies, and Robert looks behind the movies to see what's really going on. And a lot is that we don't see. The movies are filled with symbolism, and there is the deepest strain of things like, alchemy, which Robert is an expert on, in movie symbolism. We're going to learn all about that. Robert is an attorney, oddly enough, a Freemason, a philosopher, a historian. He's an antiquarian. He's a theologian, a writer, an editor, a mystic, very definitely. He describes himself also as a showman. I would agree with that. And he is a lawyer. So I may have said that already, but anyway. Welcome to Dreamland, Robert. It's so great to have you back.
Well, thank you, Whitley, for that wonderful introduction. It is my pleasure to be here. And I can't believe it has been, I don't know how many times I've been on with you. It's been quite a few. And it's always great to return. And thank you for having me on. I appreciate it.
Well, it's always fun. And, we're here to have to do serious things and to have serious fun. And this is really serious fun, because when we walk into the movies or turn on the TV, something is happening. It's not necessarily bad, but it can be. And but the important thing is to look behind the scenes and understand it. And you have to wonder where some of these people come from. Because the symbolism and this in many movies is so exotic and well worked out and advanced. What are the possible motives of some of the most symbolically committed directors and writers and actors, do you think?
Well, I think when you're looking at Hollywood and you're looking at Hollywood films, in a nutshell, these directors and the producers see themselves as artists. They see themselves as modern-day Leonardo da Vinci's, Botticelli's, Michelangelo's. And if you go back in time and you look at the Renaissance masters, you will find the inclusion of all sorts of hermetic, occult themes in their works of art. Whether it be, like I said, the three that I just named, you could find it in the Last Supper painting, you could find it in the St. John the Baptist painting of da Vinci, Botticelli certainly. And I think they are carrying on this tradition of incorporating these hermetic and arcane themes in their films because it is, in fact, a work of art. They view these movies as high art. And I find, at least in my opinion, that, when these movies include these very deep esoteric themes, symbolisms, archetypes, call it what you will, it imbues the film, it elevates the film to a higher level. And I think that's one of the main reasons that they do it. Of course, you can always look towards the sinister, that this is a form of mind control or manipulation. You can cast a counter argument to it, that it's a form of enlightenment. If you go back to the Renaissance and read some of the Renaissance masters, they'll tell you that, meditation on the archetypes is a form of divinity, and becoming conscious of it is in a form of enlightenment. Certainly you have, you can turn to the government. They have motives for, dabbling in Hollywood. I was just on another show, and certainly when you look at, like the Sherlock Holmes movies of Basil Rathbone and Nigel Bruce, the early ones, those are complete war propaganda. So there are multiple reasons why Hollywood does this, but I think if you just sat down to a man with a director, and just ask them, I think that you would find that the inclusion of this material elevates the film into another stratosphere. That's my take on it.
Yeah, it does. It makes the film important. Do you think films actually do work on our unconscious in some deep way, symbolically? Oh. I mean, are they doing something? Because a film is an expression of light, and light is the most powerful force, cultural force in the world. Tell us about that.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with you. I mean, you're dealing with, when you talk about what you're suggesting, is you're delving into the works of people like Carl Jung, Plato, those characters, you know, even like you know, people like Emanuel Swedenborg, Jakob Böhm, people like that, who will, you know, you get into the archetypes and archetypal imagery, and the art of memory. You know, the inclusion of the archetypes is something that is shared by humankind. It's buried within our subconscious mind. So bringing it to light, or incorporating it, it entices the human to become invested in the film. I'm aware of it, so I can see it when I watch a movie. Many people are not aware of it. They just sit back and think, oh, you know, that's really interesting. I'd like to go see that again. I really like that movie. Well, there's a real reason why you really liked it. And it has to do with these archetypes that are lingering in your subconscious mind that you're not aware of, that are being brought to light, that are being put to you on the screen, you know, in a form of a passion play almost, that is drawing you in like a moth to fire. I'm aware of it. I know it. So I, you know, for me, when I see a movie like Star Wars or The Matrix or Harry Potter, I see the same thing over and over again. I see the same cast of characters, the same archetypes just reappearing, only they're renamed and rebranded. I mean, this is very potent, material that can definitely, well, not can definitely, that definitely works on a subconscious and conscious level.
A lot of people see the movies as having desensitized us to a lot of things that we should be sensitive to, like ultraviolence. Is there also something else going on, though? Is there an attempt, maybe even a conscious attempt, to sensitize us? Well, like, for example, there were found between the Masonic temple in up in Hollywood and the old Paramount Studios. I believe it was Paramount. Yeah, it might not have been. I think it might have been another. I think I'm wrong about that. I think it's another studio. Tunnels that went back and forth. Do you know about that?
Yes.
Tell us about it.
Yeah, there was there. No, that's absolutely true. There was a series of tunnels. I believe they led to the old Masonic Temple in Hollywood, which I believe now is the El Capitan Theater.
Yeah, that's right.
Which, you know, and they led from a lot of the major Hollywood studios. This should really come as no surprise because most of the Hollywood studios, if not all of them, going back, you know, to Hollywood's beginning, Freemasonry has walked hand in hand with Hollywood. All the major studios were founded by Freemasons. All the early directors were Freemasons. There are exceptions, of course. The most notable is Walt Disney. He was not a Mason, but he was in a group called Demolé, which was the Masonic Boy Scouts, and that had an impact on him. But he never advanced to Freemasonry. But he was in Demolé. Interestingly, Walt Disney was J. Edgar Hoover's spy in Hollywood, and Hoover was also a Freemason. But loads of the early Hollywood directors, and you know, the Warner Brothers, you know, all those guys, Cecil B. DeMille, these guys were all Freemasons. The one earlier on, the names are escaping me right now. The guys who founded Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer, MGM, all of them were Masons. So Hollywood walks hand in hand with Freemasonry, without question. And you can certainly say, you can craft an argument that, you know, this could be a reason why some of these esoteric themes turn up in cinema. I think that's more of a backdrop. I think it serves more of a backdrop than an intentional hand, because certainly not all movies do include, esoteric themes or Masonic themes or anything like that. Certainly a lot do. But no, that is absolutely true. And the reason behind the tunnels was, certainly when they got off work, they used these tunnels. Of course, they were stars and they didn't want to be harassed by the public. So they would just take this series of catacombs to the Masonic temple that led from the studios. And my understanding of it is the tunnels, you could see the entrance to them, but they don't exist anymore. I think they've caved in. Because I know, I think Jimmy Fallon films in the El Capitan Theater. I think he was talking about it on one of his shows. So, no, that is actually a true story regarding the Freemasons in Hollywood.
It's fascinating because you're being a Freemason yourself. What would you tell us? There's an awful lot of conspiracy theory out there about Masons. There always has been. What would you tell us about Masonry?
It's a fraternal order that officially comes on the map in 1717 in London, England. It exists prior to that, of course. How far back it goes is a question of complete debate. The one thing that Masonry does is it incorporates and includes loads of esoteric doctrines from the past. You get into ideas of sacred geometry, the seven liberal arts of sciences, Hermeticism, the art of memory, Rosicrucianism, Gnosticism, alchemy, which you mentioned earlier. These are all elements that you will find in Freemasonry. And it's very important because you will find, and especially with the formation of this country, that the founders were using Masonry and using the symbols and teachings of Masonry to form a country around. This is irrefutable. There was, in the early days of the country, a conspiracy that was working behind the scenes to sort of manipulate the political system Masonically. The leader of this was a guy named DeWitt Clinton. He was the former mayor of New York City and the former governor of New York State. You may have heard the term in your travels, something known as the Colombian Illuminati. This is the American brand of the Illuminati. You know, the European brand was the one led by Spartacus Weishaupt. The American brand was called the Colombian Illuminati, and the guy who led it was DeWitt Clinton. This got blown up in the 1820s with something known as the William Morgan Affair, where this was completely exposed. And there was a tremendous backlash against Freemasonry, and it almost vanished. The reason it survived was a couple reasons. One is the president at the time was a man named Andrew Jackson, who was also a Freemason, who sort of refused to cave into it. Another method or way it survived was it distanced itself. Masonry came out and essentially reestablished itself as a charitable society for widows and orphans. It distanced itself from any sort of notions of the Hermetic tradition, of the occult, of the esoteric doctrines that are there, but they kind of just brushed it under the rug, as it were. And it was this sort of philosophical, this philosophy is probably the best word, that carried Freemasonry through the 19th century, through the 20th century. And it really was the emergence of the internet in the late 1990s and early 2000s that Masonry sort of rediscovered its esoteric roots. And again, this was one of the motives for me writing my first book, which was The Royal Arch of Enoch, was to reestablish the occult esoteric themes of Freemasonry, which are clearly there. And it's really only now being discovered by a new generation of Freemasons. And I say that because many of the Masons who are now, when I joined the Lodge, I joined back in 1996, 97, many of the Masons who are sort of my age now, in their late 40s, 50s, are now in their 70s and 80s. They're kind of disappearing, dying off, as it were. And the new generation coming in are, at least in my opinion, are much more interested in the esoteric side of the craft, if you catch my meaning.
Yeah. Well, the visitors are very interested in the esoteric side of the craft, I assure you. One of the things they did early on is to greet me with nine knocks in three groups of three. Now, are you able to tell us the significance of that in Masonic lore?
Well, that would be very interesting to me because the number three, of course, permeates Freemasonry. Without question, there's 3 degrees of the craft lodge, entered apprentice, fellow craft, master mason. The number nine in the American context is very interesting within Freemasonry. This is an allusion in the Royal Arch ceremony, especially in the York Rite tradition. The secret name of God, the hidden wisdom that Masonry conceals, is kept under nine arches. And you will find this theme of nine arches, nine, the number nine being used to guide to enlightenment. You will find this. I mean, the one that comes to mind is the is Dante Alighieri's Inferno, where, you know, Lucifer, the light bearer, is under nine levels of hell. This is reflective of things, of the doctrines of Kabbalah, of the celestial hierarchies of Pseudo-Dionysius, which I believe are nine also, which are essentially these levels of spiritual purification that the soul must undergo in order to receive, in order to obtain the supreme Godhead. So the number nine is a very heavy number when it comes to spiritual enlightenment. This is always reflective of Kabbalah, the Sephirot, the spiritual hierarchies of Pseudo-Dionysius, who was carrying on the occult traditions of Jesus through St. Paul. This you'll find in the Hermetica. They call them the seven governors in the Hermetica. So, this is resonating with this idea of spiritual purification, which you will find in Freemasonry.
And it's also a very important part of the Gurdjieff work, which I have been involved with. We're going to take a brief break for our free Dreamlanders. Folks, we'll be right back.
UnknownCountry.com. It's huge. It's much more than just a Whitley Strieber book site. It contains thousands of hours of interviews, meditations, podcasts of all kinds. My original hypnosis tapes are there. You can actually hear the moment that I discovered that I, at least, was not alone in this universe in the office of Dr. Donald Klein so many years ago. Whitley Strieber audiobooks, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, Breakthrough, Majestic, and so much more, powerful meditations, but more even than all that, it is a community of people who are either looking to gain contact or actually in contact now. There is no community like it in the world. It is absolutely unique. Contact really is happening here. That's what these shows are all about. That's what my life and this website are about. It's real, and it can be of enormous benefit to us individually and to mankind as long as we take our part and do it our way. This is what being a member of Unknown Country is about. So go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today. Join us and join, very frankly, the future. There's a new world coming if we can take it. What does that mean? The first part of the message is, if we can take it for ourselves on our own terms. The second part of the message is, can we bear the newness and the huge expansion of human consciousness that is going to be involved? Can we take it? A new world. It doesn't mince words. It tells the good, the bad, and the ugly like it is. And it leaves a message behind. Can you do this? Do you want to? Do we have an alternative? Right now, at this point in history, mankind is either going to get a lot bigger or not. I choose to go forward. I choose to live for and in the future. I choose the future. A new world. We can take it. Available in hardcover, softcover, audiobook, and Kindle.
We're talking to Robert W. Sullivan IV about his book Cinema Symbolism 3, and we're going to get into some movies shortly, deeply, into a lot of movies. Robert's website is robertwsullivaniv.com. That is correct, isn't it? Yes.
Yes.
Robert W. And don't forget the IV, or you will find, as I did, that the internet can't find you and will tell you that this site doesn't exist, but it does. It's robertwsullivaniv.com. You can learn more about his work there. Now, I would like to start with a movie that is very personally relevant to me. And folks, I hope I touch on things that matter to you. And if not, well, hopefully Robert will be with us in a meeting for subscribers at some time after his show. And you can ask your specific questions about movies we missed there, if you are a subscriber. I want to talk about Jacob's Ladder, which you touch on only briefly. It was very meaningful to me because this sense of living between the worlds of the physical and the non-physical is very much a part of my own life. Can you talk a little bit about that movie and your impressions of it?
Absolutely. Jacob's Ladder is a movie that I actually analyzed much more in depth in my second movie book, Cinema Symbolism 2. So there's a fuller analysis there. But yes, this is a movie made by Adrian Lyne, who is very well versed in this material. And Jacob's Ladder is sort of what I kind of call the MK Ultra CIA movie put on film. And it is essentially the movie that became The Sixth Sense a few years later by M. Night Shyamalan. If you see The Sixth Sense without the benefit of seeing Jacob's Ladder, as I was originally, you will think that The Sixth Sense was, you know, pretty original. But after you see the Jacob's Ladder, which I think came out about 7, 8, maybe 9 years earlier, it is really much of what Shyamalan used in The Sixth Sense comes out of Jacob's Ladder. That's irrefutable. I very much like the movie because this is one of those movies that walks a fine line between what I call alchemical cinema and Gnosticism. And there is overlap between the two. It always has to be borne in mind that the Renaissance and medieval alchemists borrowed their ideas from the ancient Gnostics. So there is overlap between the two. Ultimately, both of them have the same goal, at least in the spiritual sense, which is purification of the soul, changing ignorance into enlightenment, base metal to gold, as it were, for the profane. And this is exactly what's going on in Jacob's Ladder. Of course, I guess I'm going to have to spoil the movie. So if you haven't seen it, you may want to put this on mute or go watch the movie, then come back. He's killed. The character of Jacob, I believe his name is Singer, is killed at the very beginning of the movie in Vietnam. And the rest of the movie is him living in a false reality, in sort of his own self-created purgatory. He's not alive, and he's living in this illusionary world. And of course, this echoes Valentinian Gnosticism, that this world is an illusion, that this world is a false reality. Of course, if you really want to see that on screen, take a look at the first Matrix movie. And it is suggested in Jacob's Ladder that he begins to start seeing demons and these very strange creatures. And it is suggested that the reason he is seeing them is that he has been unwittingly an experiment of the United States government, that he has essentially been fed Agent Orange unknowingly, and that he is now years later living in New York. This is, you know, years after the Vietnam War, and this is after the beginning. I should say that it starts out at the beginning. At the beginning of the movie, it starts in Vietnam, and he appears to be being exposed to Agent Orange or something parallel to it. And then the movie then changes to New York City, where he's working at the post office. And it is suggested that the reason that he is seeing these demons and these grotesque monsters is that it's the side effects of this chemical that he was exposed to. This turns out not to be the case. He is actually seeing demons, and it is at some point in time explained to him by this character named Louis DiNardo, who is played by Danny Aiello, who tells him exactly what's going on with him, that he's essentially living in this false reality, and that these demons that he's seeing are sent from hell, but they're not there to punish him. They're basically trying to burn away his past. It is explained as the film progresses that his son died, and that he's clinging to the death of his son. And that's the reason that he's remaining in this false reality. And at the very end of the movie, he comes to understand this. And he transitions from this phony existence into the light. He essentially ascends a staircase with his deceased son, who, interestingly, is Macaulay Culkin. There's an interesting story with that. They ascend the staircase and they both enter heaven, and that's where the movie concludes. It is both Gnostic and alchemical because it's a journey of enlightenment. He has to come to understand, much like Dorothy Gale and much like Alice from Alice in Wonderland, they have to have an epiphany. They have to come to know thyself. But it is also alchemical, and it's a fine line because it's a transition. He changes. He changes from this person or this entity that's hanging on into a spiritual being. There is a fine line between Gnostic and alchemical cinema. Like I said, I may be splitting hairs, and this is one that kind of does. Jacob's Ladder is a movie that kind of does. But it's a very good movie. I love Jacob's Ladder. I think it's a great film. The interesting story with Macaulay Culkin was this is his first movie. And if you watch Jacob's Ladder, I do not believe he is billed. I do not believe he is credited anywhere in the film at all. And there was a reason for this, and that was because about 2 weeks after Jacob's Ladder was released, I believe it came out right around Halloween of 1990, so we're almost talking 31 years ago. About 3 weeks later, a movie was released called Home Alone, which was Macaulay Culkin's, you know, breakout movie. And the reason they suppressed his name in Jacob's Ladder was they didn't want it to detract from Home Alone. They didn't want him to be known as, oh, this was the kid from Jacob's Ladder. Of course, if you see it, you'll recognize him instantly. Yes. But it's because of that reason that they wanted the big splash to be Home Alone, which I believe was just released 2 weeks later after Jacob's Ladder. So that's why if you watch Jacob's Ladder, you're going to be sitting there saying, oh, that's Macaulay Culkin. But when you watch the credits, I don't think his name appears anywhere. If it does, it's very buried in there.
It doesn't, not in the copies I have.
Yeah, that's true, and that's the reason why. So, no, Jacob's Ladder is one of those movies that is Gnostic and alchemical, and it's just a great movie overloaded with esoteric themes, and all the elements of symbolic and spiritual alchemy are present in Jacob's Ladder.
My own inner work is centered on the pyramid text in the Pyramid of Unas. And in that text, there is a ladder in the spine, which is known as the Ladder of Osiris. And that became Jacob's Ladder because it is the ladder of ascension, the ladder of ascending to heaven. And so the movie touches on what I regard as probably the deepest ascension symbolism the world possesses, and the quote about the demons are being really angels is a remarkable quote, because it's very much how my experience personally of the world of the dead works. The whole movie is, because one of the things that's a tremendous challenge for many people who have died is two levels. First, they have a great deal of difficulty, some of them, realizing that they are dead. And they continue to live in their lives in an illusion, just like Jacob, just like in the movie. The other thing is, when they do realize it, then they don't know where to go, because everything stays the same. They're moving around in a world that no longer recognizes their existence. They don't know how to ascend. And it's why this movie is so important, because it gives you an idea of what you need to find in yourself and to give up in order to go on with it beyond this life. And I think it's a remarkably important movie, folks. And we will have a list of spoilers, if there are any more, in the show description. But if you haven't watched it, you should certainly watch Jacob's Ladder. And if you have watched it, after hearing this, and after reading the book, after reading this marvelous book, Cinema Symbolism 3, read it. Go to it again. And it's similar. Cinema Symbolism 2, isn't it, which the Jacob's Ladder is more thoroughly analyzed in. So go back to cinema, Symbolism 2 and read about Jacob's Ladder. And it's well worth doing. Now, I want to move on. And in fact, we've come up on a, on a second break. Our last break, you'll be happy to know, Free Dreamlanders, and I won't be whining at you anymore. But do enjoy these commercials, and we are sending all kinds of juju out to you right now so that you'll actually do what we're asking and you know what it is. We'll be right back. This is Whitley Strieber. Listen to me now from June of 2010 talking to Alan Lammers about an incredible thing that happened to him on the island of Sulawesi in Indonesia. Here you are in South Sulawesi in the little town in the district of Sandu Batu. You were, what happened? You were told something rather strange.
Well, we were told before we went, like my friends that I worked with in, with the NGO, they told me that when you pack, because it kind of happened by accident, I went out to buy a raincoat. It rains quite a bit in this part of the world. And so I went out and I bought a yellow raincoat. And my friend said, I'm sorry, you can't take that to Walla Walla. And I said, well, why not? And he says, well, you can't wear that color. So anyways, excuse me. So I thought, okay, well, what colors can I wear? They said, well, you can only wear black or white. You cannot wear any bright colors, no bright green, especially no yellow. And, you know, that's all you should bring. And I said, well, what would happen? And they said, well, people disappear.
You will find the rest of that story, and it is brain-bending, in the June 5th edition of Dreamland, June 5, 2010 edition of Dreamland in the unknowncountry.com archive. This archive is one of the richest of its kind in the world, probably is the richest of its kind in the world, filled with extraordinary shows, of which this show is certainly one, this show with Alan Lammers. You will never have heard anything like it. It does what Dreamland is here to do. It opens your mind to the fact that we live inside a hidden reality that we prefer not to acknowledge, but not here. Here on unknowncountry.com, we do acknowledge it. We live in it and we love it. Subscribe today. You can't go wrong. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and get started. We're talking to Robert W. Sullivan, Jr., his new book, Cinema Symbolism 3. And if you're really interested in the movies, I would recommend you get all of these because they're not books you maybe would read from cover to cover, but dipping into them is just so much fun. I've been dipping into them all for years. If you can, I mean, you can imagine how many books I get in a year on Dreamland. It's a very much of a book-oriented podcast. These three are still on my shelf after all these years, and there's a reason for it. They are filled with insight, and our consciousness is very involved in entertainment. That entertainment isn't entertainment. It's inner work in another form, and we have to remember that when we go to the movies or we watch TV. The next thing I want to talk about is actually both a movie and a TV show, because there's a wonderful, it starts out the book, in fact, this is in chapter one, it's a wonderful chapter about Bates Motel, which was on the A&E network for five seasons between 2013 and 2017. It's a modern retelling of Psycho. Now, first, I'm sure you can still find it somewhere online. There's no question in my mind about that. I don't know exactly where, but I'm sure you can. Can you tell us about why you find it so important?
Oh, I love that show. I'm a huge Alfred Hitchcock fan, And I always thought Psycho was a great movie. And again, that's one that, you know, when you're dealing with Hitchcock, again, you're dealing with one of these, you know, cinematic grandmasters when it comes to this stuff, to these, you know, allusions and things like that. So Psycho has a lot going on in it. And I, when I watched Bates Motel, yeah, I mean, there's all sorts of little hidden goodies in there. And, you know, I just really liked the show. I thought it was well made. I thoroughly enjoyed it. I like the way they started it out. I like the way they concluded it. I like the way they brought it up to speed in modern times. And I just, when I decided to take it on, the reason I was happy to take it on was because it gave me an excuse to talk about Psycho, the original with Hitchcock. So I was able to include some of the material for Psycho and then go into the Bates Motel. And I mean, yeah, there's just, you know, all sorts of little things in that movie that, or in the TV show that I thought were great. I mean, if you watch Psycho, you'll know that the mother was buried in periwinkle blue. And when you watch Bates Motel, the actress who played Norma Bates, Vera Farmiga, she is often costumed in periwinkle blue. And of course, that's intentional. And then towards the end of the season, the end of the series, excuse me, this was in season five, they paid homage to the guy who Norman Bates is based upon. Which is Ed Gein, who was a very gruesome serial killer out west. He was in Wisconsin, and he adored his mother, and he used to rob graves and skin them alive and dress up as the skins and dress up as his mother and things like that. And he was out of Plainfield, Wisconsin. And if you watch Bates Motel, and I believe it's in season five, you'll see the records that he's playing are called Plainfield, or on a label called Plainfield. That's an allusion to Ed Gein, who again is the basis, the person, you know, is the who Norman Bates comes from, you know, who's Norman Bates is based upon. So I love Bates Motel. I love Psycho. And yeah, this was the first chapter of the book. And I thought, what a great way to open it up with just this tremendous TV show. And of course, Alfred Hitchcock, who is one of these directors who just is very adroit with this material.
I think Alfred Hitchcock went very deep in a lot of ways. He was a difficult man, by all accounts, to be with. But he knew things, and he maybe studied things. Is there any indication that he had any conscious esoteric knowledge?
I don't think he was a Freemason or anything like that. But, I mean, he does use cinematic techniques to convey things to your subconscious mind. I mean, this has been well documented. I pointed out in my books, I mean, the whole thing with, we can just stick with Psycho. I mean, it's the clothing. And that's something I should point out. When these movie makers go to work, they are gifted with a palette of techniques, that they can draw from, to invest, the movie with different arcane doctrines. I mean, it's not just a symbol on a screen. It can be costuming, it can be wardrobe, it can be music. The very actor or actress who is cast can actually have an occult meaning that works on something known as the art of memory, that is designed to draw something forth from some, you know, pop culture, you know, other pop culture icon. So these filmmakers use a lot of techniques. They paint with a multicolored palette, as it were. And one of the things that Hitchcock uses is wardrobe. And of course, Marion Crane, before she steals the money, is always wearing white, you know, and the white lingerie and the white clothing to denote her innocence. And then after she steals it, of course, it's the black lingerie that comes out. And you'll see this in other Hitchcock movies as well. Dial M for Murder is another one. And you'll see other movie makers using this as well, using this exact same technique with the clothing. Adrian Lyne is another one. The guy we just talked about with Jacob's Ladder, if you watch his movie called Fatal Attraction, he costumes Glenn Close, who is the schizoid personality, in strictly black and white. She either wears all black, all white, or black and white. And that's to indicate that she's, you know, the split personality, this suffering from this good girl, bad girl complex, as it were. So costuming is one of the many techniques that Hollywood uses, and Hitchcock uses this to great effect. So no, I mean, again, you know, I mean, I can't speak to how much knowledge or, you know, what wisdom Hitchcock exactly possessed, but he obviously had some knowledge of it, because you'll see it, you know, you'll see his, you know, these techniques being used in his cinema. So, I mean, you know, he clearly was aware, you know, of something.
I don't believe you've ever analyzed the Clint Eastwood film A Perfect World, have you?
No, I've never taken that on. In fact, when I do shows, I am inevitably asked about a movie that I haven't seen.
Yeah, and, I was afraid of that.
I have not seen that one, unfortunately.
Well, you should look at it because it's about a very evil man acquiring a guardian angel who, in the end, leads his soul to heaven. It's an extraordinary movie, and I've often wondered. I can't believe that Clint Eastwood knew the inner meaning of the movie, but certainly the writer and probably the director did. Now let's talk a little. You've made a brief reference to Gnosticism, and Gnosticism plays a huge role in Hollywood. Tell us first what Gnosticism is in your view, and then we're going to get into why it's such an important part of the hidden symbolism of Hollywood. Go ahead and tell us first about what it is.
It's very popular in Hollywood. It is a very complex doctrine, religious doctrine. It's a heresy. It's a Christian heresy. And the three main fountainheads of Gnostic thought are Mani, Basilides, and Valentinus. And the one that probably most people are aware of, but they don't know they're aware of it, is the Valentinian strain of Gnosticism. And this is the one that essentially holds that the reality that we're living in is a sort of lesser false reality created by this hidden puppet master character known as the Demiurge, which is it's a Greek word that means the maintenance man. And the cosmology of Gnosticism is somewhat complex, but I'll just try to explain it quickly. And this is, again, the main strain of it. This is the Valentinian strain. That he holds the theory or the theology is that there is this god out there that is called the monad. It has a name, but it's generally known as the monad. It turns up in Neoplatonism. It's known as the one. And this is what you would call the supreme spiritual godhead out there. And this monad has emanations. It emanates these beings called aeons. And these run parallel with what you would call the Sephirot in Kabbalah. And one of these, they're personifications of the monad. And as any Gnostic will tell you, and Valentinus will tell you, is the monad is this unknowable, unfathomable godhead that it is just so overwhelming. It can't be studied. It can't be named. It can't be known. One of these aeons that personifies the sacred feminine aspect of the monad tries to examine him. And this is what is called Sophia. And she is punished for trying to understand something that can't be understood. And she is cast out of this heavenly area that the monad exists in called the Pleroma. And of course, this should sound familiar. If this sounds familiar, it's the casting out of Lucifer in the Christian doctrine. Sophia is cast out of the Pleroma and comes to live in something known, it's a void, it's known as the Kenoma. And while she is there, she births this lesser god called the Demiurge. And this demiurgic character fashions our universe, but it's inferior. It's a false reality. If you believe the Gnostics, we are living in this universe created by this sort of screwed up Jehovah. He's messed up. He's like a screw up. And the reason this sort of helps explains the existence of evil in this world, because the Demiurge is sort of this misfit god. It associates with the God of the Old Testament. There was a Christian heretic out there named Marikon, who essentially equated the God of the Old Testament, the God of Moses and Abraham, to the Demiurge. So if you look at the Old Testament, the God of the Old Testament just wants to kill everybody, drown everybody, hates everybody. This isn't the case of the God of the New Testament. The God of the New Testament wants to love everybody. So one of the things that Marikon came up with was that Jesus must have been sent from this monad thing to kind of help humankind back to this supreme Godhead. And of course, the Valentinian strain is that this universe is created by this, you know, ruling God known as the Demiurge, and he doesn't rule alone. He has this coterie of angels and kind of demonic enforcers that rule it with him called Archons, and the Archons' sole purpose is to keep humankind in stasis, to keep them asleep, to keep them turned away from spiritualism. This doctrine is very, very popular in Hollywood. And of course, this, you know, what I'm discussing is some of the greatest Hollywood movies ever made. I mean, this is the first Matrix movie where Neo, meaning new, is living in this false reality, and he wants spiritual awakening, and he wakes up that the world is this falsehood. And he, you know, his whole purpose is to awaken mankind that they're enslaved to this demiurgic creature. And of course, the demiurge turns up in part two. He's known as the architect. And of course, if you look at it, this is all the Valentinian strain. He has this coterie of angels, demons to keep humankind asleep, known as the agents, led by Smith. You can find this in, you know, movies such as, you know, The Truman Show, where he comes to realize Sea Haven is this false reality created by this demiurgic character called Christoph. Dark City is another one. John Murdoch, who wants to awaken mankind to the false reality of the strangers. So this is a very, very popular theology or heresy in Hollywood. And the reason why is because it's a journey of self-enlightenment. The character ultimately comes to know themselves, which is the Hermetic maxim, to understand their place in this world. And I think that's one of the reasons why it's so popular, is because the person sitting there, you know, can emulate with this, can say, oh, okay, you know, what's my place in this world? It gives the audience, the viewer in the audience, something to think that, you know, hey, you know, here's this character, this nobody living in this false world, who comes to understand that the reality that I'm in is no good. Maybe I can do something like this. It's very inspiring. Gnosticism proper is something that Hollywood loves, loves to toy around with. I mean, some of the greatest movies, I think, are essentially Gnostic cinema. I mean, you'll find it going back to the very beginning of Hollywood with Metropolis. I mean, I named a couple there. You can throw in movies like Donnie Darko, Fight Club. These are inherently Gnostic films. So yeah, this is a very popular topic in Hollywood.
Yeah, it's a very important topic in our lives, because we are, you know, I can't get away from the idea of the Archons, because the internet is replete with material about the evil of the Archons. But the movies are not so sure. I'll give you an example, of course, going back to Jacob's Ladder, that particular quote we were talking about earlier is when he's working remind me of the name of the character who says it.
It's Louis DiNardo. He's his chiropractor.
Right. Louis DiNardo is a chiropractor, and he's working on the spine when he says this. And that is to say, he is literally engaged in perfecting the ladder of Osiris, or Jacob's ladder, which is the spine. And he says, the only thing that burns in hell is the part of you that won't let go of your life, your memories, your attachments. They burn them all the way, but they're not punishing you. They're freeing your soul. And when that happens, the demons turn out to be angels. And that's true of the experience of inner journey, too. And it happened to me in physical life, in the sense that the visitors, when I first met them, were demons. There's no question in my mind. They were terrifying and absolutely frightening beings that dragged me out of my home in the middle of the night and raped me. They raped me. They stole my semen. I mean, it was just the most awful thing you could imagine. But instead of saying no to it, I went for it and tried to understand. And now they're not demons anymore. They're angels in my life. It happened to me personally. And that's why it's so important to me. Not just that one movie, but the whole journey you're on. I think it's a very powerful, very important human journey. And Gnosticism is, you know, I've been reading the Pistis Sophia lately, which is a big and to say that it's impossible to understand is accurate. I think it's very difficult to understand Gnosticism. But the basic ideas are there. And let's go a little deeper now and move to Dark City, which is also about, I think it's, well, you describe it as Aeons, Archons, and Tuning, the fallen strangers of Dark City. As a man is, so he sees. You start your analysis with a quote from William Blake. Can you tell us a little bit about Dark City and its significance in terms of its vision of the Archons and the Aeons?
Absolutely. And I started the quote with William Blake because he is a English author and artist who flirts with Gnosticism. And in fact, he creates his own cosmology, and he has a Gnostic demiurge in there. He calls it Eurozine. That's his Gnostic demiurge. And if you, the most famous image of Eurozine is the one where he's kneeling down with the Masonic square and compasses in front of the sun. I believe that's the front piece to Europe, a prophecy, I want to say. So Blake creates his own Gnostic cosmology, only though he gives, he renames things, but the Eurozine is his demiurge. And yeah, Dark City is an incredibly Gnostic movie. I would argue that John Murdoch would probably go down as the greatest example of a Valentinian Christ if it wasn't for Neo Anderson the next year in The Matrix. Because again, you have all of your Gnostic elements present in Dark City. You have the false reality. You have the Gnostic Christ figure in Murdoch trying to wake up the people that, you know, their reality is an illusion, that it's false. You have the strangers take on a dual role in this movie as they play both the Archons and the Aeons. They are clearly representative of this, of Sophia, who is, they're fallen, they're dying, and they're trying, and they're doing what she tried to do. Sophia tries to understand the monad. She tries to understand something that can't be understood. She tries to put a name on the unnameable, and she's cast out, and she goes into degeneration. And of course, this is what happens to the strangers. You know, they're this fallen race of aliens. And they're trying to do exactly what the Aeons did. They're trying to commodify the unknowable. That is, they're trying to package and rebrand the human soul. They're trying to understand something that can't be understood, just as Sophia tried to examine the demiurge and commodify it. They're trying to do the same thing with the whole human soul, and they can't do it. This is why they're failing. This is why they're dying. But they also represent the Archons, in that they are keeping humankind asleep. They're keeping the inhabitants of this dark city under watch. Literally, they're putting them to sleep, you know, quite literally. And, you know, the movie is just overwrought with esoteric symbolism. I mean, when John Murdoch comes to awaken at the end, I mean, he goes to Shell Beach, which the sun comes out, enlightenment. I mean, the sun, since day one, has always been a symbol of, you know, of the light. I mean, it is the light. You have, I mean, I like the scene where, you know, he's on the slab. He's Da Vinci's Vitruvian man, and he comes awake and beats up on the strangers. You know, he's the perfected person, and of course, you know the whole idea of, you know, this begins where at the beginning where his third eye is awakened. You know, where they're trying to stick the needle. Kiefer Sutherland is trying to stick the needle in you know, in his forehead, in his third eye, and this is what brings him around originally to consciousness. I mean, and he becomes so good at it, he becomes like Neo does a year later in The Matrix, where he realizes that the reality is false and becomes able to manipulate it. This is what they call tuning in Dark City. Neo performs the same skill, you know, with the bullet time theatrics, you know, when the Archons, the agents are shooting at him and he can whiz around the bullets. He realizes that this is just a false reality, and he can, you know, becomes aware of it so much so that he becomes able to manipulate it. So absolutely, Dark City is a fantastic example of the Valentinian thread of Gnosticism, where the person becomes aware of this false reality and takes on the role of what I would call the Gnostic Christ, the Valentinian Christ, which in the Valentinian scheme is a little different than the Orthodox Jesus. You know, in the Orthodox one, Jesus is sent here to redeem sin, grant people the afterlife, things like that. In the Gnostic cosmology, Jesus's role is a little different. He's the divine awakener. He's the guy coming down here from the monad to wake people up to the falsehood of the demiurge. So he takes on a bit of a different role in the Gnostic cosmology than it does in Christian orthodoxy. Me personally, I think the Gnostic Jesus is a little more interesting than the Orthodox one. But no, Dark City is a prime example of the Valentinian Gnostic strain in cinema. And like I said, I'll just wrap up on this. It would probably be remembered today as one of the greatest Gnostic movies. It is, but it kind of had its thunder stolen a year later with The Matrix, which kind of, you know, like I said, Neo is probably more remembered today as the best example of a Valentinian Christ than John Murdoch is.
In the third half hour, one of the things we're going to discuss is The Matrix, and we're also going to discuss Christopher Nolan's Dark Knight trilogy and Todd Phillips' Joker. But before we go there, I would like to end the first hour with a discussion of Star Wars. And Free Dreamlanders and subscribers too, this is a message for everybody. We need new subscribers always, and there's nothing like word-of-mouth subscribers. If you love this website and this show, tell your friends about it. And Free Dreamlanders, tell your friends about it too. They might actually subscribe. And this is the only way we make money. We're not beholden to any outside advertisers for the reason that we want to be truly free. Okay, now let's go on to Blade Runner. To the Star Wars saga. I think the best way to, there's so much there. We've been talking about Gnosticism. Let's talk about the Tao of Star Wars and the awakening of the Force and what that means.
Yeah, Star Wars is a vast study. I originally took on the original movies in the first movie book, and I did a couple of the other ones in the newer ones in the most recent book. But yeah, I mean, you know, the key to understanding Star Wars proper is the Joseph Campbell monomyth, with these archetypal components of mythology that are prevalent in Star Wars. I think I know where you're going with this. The one that I was very fascinated with was, I don't think it really got the credit that it deserved, was the one, The Force Awakens. This was the one,
yes,
this was episode
that's
7.
Where I'm going.
Yeah, I'll stick with that one then. This was the one that came out. This is the most, you know, the newer versions, the first of the new ones that came out with Walt Disney making them, J.J. Abrams. And episode 7, The Force Awakens, is essentially, for lack of a better word, a remake of episode 4, which is the very first one, which is A New Hope. But there is this very Valentinian Gnostic undercurrent with The Force Awakens that's very difficult to pick up on. There's a lot going on in the movie. I won't get into it unless you ask me later, but the casting of Max von Sydow at the very beginning is done on purpose. That's very interesting, the reason why he appears in it. But the Gnostic strain in it has to do with Rey and the defecting stormtrooper, Finn. You can look at them as sort of the Gnostic rebels, and you can clearly, if you want to apply it, you can clearly see the First Order as sort of the, you know, Valentinus was always coming up against what he called oppressive Christians, you know, who were always trying to distort him. They didn't like what he was saying. They didn't like the idea of, you know, they didn't like his take on Jesus. They didn't like the Gnostic take on Jesus. They wanted to stick with the Orthodox take on it. And you can clearly, if you look at this movie and you pull back from it, you can clearly see Ren and Finn as the Gnostic rebels, as the Valentinian rebels who are sort of railing against the First Order, who you can clearly see are meant to be the Orthodox Christians. Kylo, of course, is lightsaber, is the crucifix. And then they are in the temple talking to Snoke, who is sort of their godhead. But of course, he's a hologram. He's an illusion. And again, this is, you know, the Gnostic idea that it's false, that it's a fake reality. And you could clearly equate Snoke to the demiurge, the master of the false reality. So, you know, if you watch it, and they sort of brand right off the bat as Ren and Finn as Antichrist. If you watch the movie and you pay close attention to it, when the stormtroopers land on the desert planet at the very beginning, and this is when Finn is with them. And he's still costumed as a stormtrooper. The one guy dies in his arms, and he smears blood on his helmet. If you pay attention to it very carefully, that is the Hebrew letter Vav that is smeared on his head, and it's smeared not once but three times. And this is, of course, the number 6. So you have right off the bat, you have 666. Finn and the rebel ilk are being identified as Antichrist, as being anti-Orthodox Christian. And of course, this is what Valentinius had to deal with. He was viewed as a heretic, someone who should be stomped out. And you will find that you can clearly see this very subtle parallel with Finn and Ren, and the resistance are these Valentinian rebels combating the Orthodox Christians, which are the First Order. That's very subtle, but it's very, very well done. And if you pay attention to it again, there are some solar references that encircle the First Order. And again, this should come as no surprise. Jesus is often, especially in the Neoplatonic doctrines, equated with the sun. Even the early Christians confused Jesus with the rising sun. Many hold Jesus to be nothing more than a personification of the sun. And if you pay attention to Star Wars Episode 7, you will find some solar iconography very well concealed around the First Order. So, yeah, this was something that I got into in Cinema Symbolism 3, that and some of the newer Star Wars movies. So, yeah, if you like Star Wars, by all means, and you've seen the new ones, I took on the first slate of Star Wars movies back in Part 1. The newer movies appear in CS3.
Now, I'm going to go back to Max von Sydow, because if I don't, my listeners will go crazy. Everyone wants to know what you have to say about Max von Sydow.
Oh, absolutely. This is something that I called my take on this is evolving a little bit. I originally called this occult casting, and it's a title that I came up with, and I stick by it. I have evolved a little bit on it. What occult casting details is this is when a director or a filmmaker will place an actor. A specific actor in a film for occult purposes. And the reason they do this is, and von Sydow is one example of many. When I first started examining this, I thought it was a rare occurrence. It is not. It's much more widespread than even I anticipated or thought to be true. And this is when a filmmaker will place an actor or an actress in a film to draw upon their earlier cinematic baggage and thereby invest this new film with the memories of the old ones. It's an art of memory trick. Giordano Bruno, the European mystic, talked about this. Why von Sydow appears in the beginning of Star Wars The Force Awakens, when any number of actors could have played that part, that very simple part, is twofold. It is designed to conjure two earlier movies of von Sydow and draw in the imagery surrounding those movies and plant it in your subconscious mind in this new Star Wars movies. So we have von Sydow appearing in a desert planet at the very beginning of Star Wars The Force Awakens, confronting an evil overlord. What other von Sydow movies have I seen this in? Well, of course, the first one that comes to mind is The Exorcist, where von Sydow is in the desert at the very beginning and he confronts the evil statue of Pazuzu. This is very adroit. This is one of the best examples of sorcery I can think of. By placing von Sydow in the beginning of that movie, it is completely designed to wreak havoc of your subconscious mind and draw in the imagery from The Exorcist and implant it and imbue it upon the First Order, where you are now getting the demonism of Pazuzu transferred subconsciously to Kylo Ren and the First Order. The whole idea of von Sydow appearing on a desert planet is completely designed as a subconscious mnemonic, designed to resurrect The Exorcist and invest in your subconscious mind The Exorcist and the demonism associated with Pazuzu and implant that on your subconscious mind and transfer it to Kylo Ren in the First Order. That's one. The other movie that it draws upon is Dune, The David Lynch 1984 version, I know we have the new one coming out, or is out now. And it's the same thing where Von Sydow is on the desert planet of Arrakis and confronts the dark evil overlord, Baron Von Cronin. And it's the same thing. By placing Von Sydow at the beginning of Star Wars, it is designed to draw in the imagery associated with Dune, another science fiction movie, and transfer the savagery of the Harkonnens to the First Order. So this is the sort of thing these movie makers like to do. It is a complete form of sorcery. It is complete magic, and it is subconscious. It's by planting Von Sydow there, the movie makers, J.J. Abrams and Walt Disney, are drawing upon his earlier pop culture cinematic baggage from The Exorcist and from Dune and implanting it in your subconscious mind so you will equate Kylo Ren and the First Order with the demonism and the savagery of the Harkonnens and Pazuzu.
Wonderfully explained. That's absolutely fascinating. I'm so glad I asked. And folks, we're coming to the end of the first hour, and what I would like to mention here is to think about what we've been discussing, because it's actually got its own hidden meaning. It is about your mastery of your own life. Because entertainment is not just entertainment. Entertainment is part of the spiritual journey, and a lot of people who get their films before the public know this and understand it deeply. You can journey with them if you understand too. And a way to convert your entertainment from passive sitting and watching to active participation in the energies that are there for you to partake of is to read and understand books like Cinema Symbolism 3 and the other two Cinema Symbolism books. They are probably the best tool for doing this that has ever been created in the world. And don't forget that. Take it seriously. The Archons within us invoke our passivity when we sit down to be entertained. But you can change that. You can transform the demons into angels yourself if you acknowledge the power of what is there and bring your own understanding to it. Free Dreamlanders, thank you so much for being with us. We've been talking to Robert Sullivan III, his new book, Cinema Symbolism 3. I urge you to get all three and dip into them, to the movies that interest you, and really learn what you need to learn to become an active participant in this journey of energy that is the expression of light onto a screen. Okay. His website is robertwsullivaniv.com. And go there to learn more about his work and to engage with him. I'm sure you can contact him through the website. Thank you very much, Free Dreamlanders, for listening. And subscribers, we're just going to keep right on keeping on. We are headed into Batman territory now. Well, what will we find?
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by UnknownCountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.